It's a great joy and delight to be with you this weekend, and I'm very grateful to your rector for the invitation, so please thank him as well. I bring you greetings from Episcopalians across this church, from Taiwan and Micronesia, from Honduras, Ecuador, Colombia, Venezuela, from Haiti, from the Dominican Republic, from the British and U.S. Virgin Islands, from Puerto Rico, from Austria, Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, and Switzerland, and the other 99 dioceses of the United States. They pray for you. I would ask you to pray for them. What does profit mean to you? What you used to get when you sold your home? Somebody who says the world's going to end on June 23rd, 2025? The forecaster who told us last week that this snowstorm was coming? Those two words that sound alike mean quite different things, but there is a connection. The kind of profit that we think of as financial originally meant progress or advance, and proficient comes from the same root. It has the sense of moving toward perfection, as in, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world if he loses his life? The prophet, with challenging words to say, is speaking about progress towards some end, or lack of progress, whether it's a snowstorm or the goal of all creation. That kind of prophet often claims to speak for God. Garrison Keillor insists that prophets are folks who tell the truth, and most people don't really want them around because that truth is often uncomfortable. He goes on to say that prophets don't often get invited to birthday parties. Jeremiah the prophet has been appointed to speak judgment as well as hope. To pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, but also to build and to plant. It's the first part that makes people want to get rid of prophets. That's certainly what happens to Jesus in his hometown synagogue. He has just read that remarkable passage from Isaiah that talks about God's vision of abundant life. Good news for the oppressed, liberty for the captives, comfort for the grieving. And there's one line of judgment about those who are providing the oppression and captivity and death. And then Jesus says, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." His fellow villagers don't get mad until he tells them that only a few of them will get the good news, either receive it or accept it. They react the same way that we often do when somebody has the chutzpah to tell us the truth. Who does he think he is? And they try to take him out in the first century equivalent of a lynching. What do we do with challenging prophetic words or calls to judgment? There are prophets all around us if we're able to hear them. The earth is warming, and our behavior has something to do with it. Excessive profits in the financial industry have a connection to our current economic mess. How we treat our bodies in terms of food and exercise has a lot to do with the state of our own health and with the cost of health care. Those words of judgment are not words of damnation or a curse. They're a description of what the consequences of behavior are likely to be. If we keep on doing what we're doing, then this is what the future is going to look like. Prophets actually speak out of concern for our future profit, our position grounded in that overarching vision of God for a healed world. Like what Martin Luther King had to say about the moral arc of the universe bending toward justice. There are two sorts of biblical prophets. The ones like Garrison Keillor's truth tellers, who speak out about the divide between that divine vision and current reality. Prophets like Isaiah and Amos and Micah.